Is Alpha Centauri near or far? Have you ever thought about it? We Earthlings might have ended up with a natural satellite much smaller than the one we have, something like the size of Phobos or Deimos, for instance. Or we could have had a moon like our current one, but much farther away, like Callisto, which is almost 2 million kilometers from Jupiter, for example. In the worst-case scenario, we could have had no moon at all, like Venus and Mercury. Why not? The point here, though, is different. Do you think anything would have changed for our dreams of space conquest if the moon had been smaller, farther away, or even absent? The answer, I'm sure you'll agree, can only be affirmative. Without a large moon so close, encouraging our first leap, we would have hesitated much longer before venturing beyond low Earth orbits. And probably we wouldn't have had a space program if it hadn't been for the moon. Now let's take a look at what could be our next leap into interstellar space. What will be our reference point in this case? The star closest to the sun, of course. But here, good fortune seems to have deserted us. The nearest star to us is located at a distance of 4.3 light years, equivalent to 40 trillion kilometers, which is 100 million times the Earth-Moon distance. It's like 1 millimeter compared to 100 kilometers. A terrifying abyss of time and space. Is this the end of the line then? Are we unlucky to have encountered such a high hurdle? Well, maybe not. In fact, the data suggests that the typical distance between stars located within 30 light years from the Sun is about 9 light years, which is more than twice as far as Alpha Centauri, which statistically we must consider much closer than it should be then. This feature becomes even more noteworthy when focusing on yellow subgiants like the Sun and Alpha Centauri, which are the stars around which planets with the highest probability of giving rise to life. In this case, the survey data reveals their average mutual distance is a remarkable 21 light years. So in light of this data, perhaps we should consider our initial impression and conclude that we've had the same dose of luck with Alpha Centauri as we have had with the Moon. Sure, it could have been even better, but it wouldn't be logical to expect a star right in our backyard, with all the possible gravitational consequences, some of which could be quite negative. And besides, you know, every time someone asks me if I think Alpha Centauri is irrevocably far, I respond by inviting the person to perform a thought experiment. That of taking a normal A4 sheet of paper and starting to fold it. Once, twice, three times. Assuming the initial thickness of the sheet is a tenth of a millimeter, how many times would you have to fold it on itself, assuming it can be physically done, to give it a thickness similar to the distance that separates us from Alpha Centauri? Of course, the person asked this question can only widen their eyes and ask me if I'm joking. And at that point, I challenge them saying, come on, take a guess. A million times, a billion times, a trillion times. And in the face of an answer that usually involves incredibly large numbers, I triumphantly exclaim, no, to reach Alpha Centauri, you only need to fold the paper just 70 times. Then I explain that all this is made possible in mathematics by the incredible properties of exponential series. I know it's just a game, but it's a game that helps us understand how something is very difficult to make absolute judgments on certain topics, like evaluating the distance of a scientific dream. In fact, how can we consider Alpha Centauri incredibly close, incredibly far, a possible destination, an unattainable dream? The answer depends on our personal predisposition for optimism or pessimism, but also on objective technical considerations. So now we've reached the serious part of this video, where we will examine the real possibility of making the second cosmic leap after the one that took us to the moon. As we've just seen, fate has provided us with a star similar to our Sun at a cosmically acceptable distance. But in truth, do we have any chance of making this leap, and from there embarking on the colonization of the entire galaxy? Well, as painful as it is, the answer can only be a resounding no. Even a ray of light, which moves at the maximum speed allowed by the laws of physics, takes 4.3 years to reach us from Alpha Centauri, while less than 8.5 minutes are enough to bridge the gap that separates us from the Sun. In these numbers, in their relentless inevitability, lies the problem of interstellar travel. When we take into the account the size of our galaxy approximately 100,000 light-years in diameter, and that of the observable universe, over 12 billion light-years, the issue of travel in the cosmos can't help but leave a profound sense of inadequacy. To grasp our current technological shortcomings, we only need to reflect on the fact that Voyager 1, currently the fastest human-made interstellar object, is moving away from the Sun at a speed of 17 kilometers per second, and would take something like 75,000 years to reach Alpha Centauri. Traditional chemical fuel rockets would be entirely inadequate for such distances, and a drastic technological leap would then become necessary. In this regard, there are many ideas, from rockets that harness nuclear fission and fusion to those powered by matter-antimatter annihilation and massive light sails. However, these are only theoretical solutions that would still require decades of development and enormous technological and economic efforts to materialize. For a distant future, and still to be verified, some have proposed the use of warp drives, which only exist in our imagination, or wormholes, so far only theoretical constructs. Imaginative solutions derive from the extreme interpretations of general relativity. Some believe that these solutions could provide means of travel at speeds exceeding that of light. However, building larger, better, and faster spacecraft alone will not be enough. We cannot merely wait for science and technology to progress. As we will see shortly, there is a fundamental physical limitation that can slow it down, if not prevent our dreams of fast and free interstellar travel. To make interstellar travel appealing to humans, to ignite that blend of aspiration, ambition, curiosity, and competition that drives our grand endeavors, we would need to significantly increase our speed. But this is entirely impossible for several reasons. This impossibility is also demonstrated by the implicit conclusions of the famous Fermi paradox. Follow me, and then tell me if you disagree. Before moving on, don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you haven't already. Make sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on our daily videos. As Albert Einstein first pointed out in his 1905 special theory of relativity, no object with mass can surpass the speed of light. Einstein established this limit based on considerations that seemed and still seem to clash with the common sense, with which we're accustomed to evaluating physical phenomena in our everyday lives. Nevertheless, this limit has been verified in many experiments, and there is no reason to doubt its existence in the context of the matter and the universe we know. Einstein demonstrated that energy, E, of anybody is linked to its mass, m, according to the famous equation E equals mc squared, where c is the speed of light, equal to 299,792,458 kilometers per second in a vacuum. Among other things, this relationship shows that energy and mass are equivalent entities that can transform into one another. This is precisely what happens when we accelerate an object, although we may not notice it. A small part of the energy we impart to it increases its mass. However, as the velocity increases, more and more energy is needed to further boost its speed, because more energy is transformed into mass. In practice, the closer we get to the speed of light, the more massive and immovable the object becomes. If it were to travel at 99.9% of the speed of light, for example, an 80-kilogram human would have the mass of about 2 tons. Consequently, attempting to provide additional thrust to the object or spacecraft to make it surpass the light barrier would exponentially increase its mass while leaving its velocity virtually unchanged. This is why the speed, c, can be approached but never reached. In summary, bodies with mass resist being accelerated to speeds close to that of light. The closer you get to that speed, the more challenging it becomes to accelerate them further. Even if we could instantaneously reach the speed of light with some magical contraption, it would still take 4.3 years to reach the Alpha Centauri system. However, let's not give up so easily, as there might be something we're missing. Mass is not the only factor that changes with velocity. Another critical factor in relativistic space travel is time dilation. Imagine constructing a spacecraft capable of maintaining a constant acceleration during its journey. As a concrete example, let's assume the spacecraft's velocity increases by 9.8 meters per second every second, which is the acceleration objects experience when falling on Earth. This isn't an enormous acceleration and can be achieved by a sufficiently powerful car, going from 0 to 100 kilometers per hour in about 3 seconds, for instance. Nonetheless, if this acceleration were maintained consistently, the spacecraft would reach around 70% of the speed of light in little over a year measured from Earth. During this time, the spacecraft would cover a distance of about half a light year. Of course, its velocity would continue to increase steadily, getting closer and closer to the speed of light. However, keep in mind that before reaching the destination, the spacecraft would also need to decelerate. You could then plan to spend the first half of the journey with constant acceleration and the second half with constant deceleration. Simply reverse the direction of the thrusters while maintaining the same thrust. So where could you potentially reach with a spacecraft like this? From the perspective of those on Earth, it would take many years for the spacecraft to reach the nearest stars, even when traveling at speeds close to that of light. Yet for those on board the spacecraft, things would be different. Relativistic effects would come into play, altering their perception of time. Due to time dilation, the journey would seem significantly shorter for the astronauts than it does for observers on Earth. Moreover, since the spacecraft would continue to accelerate, the time gain would increase as the journey progresses. The farther the destination, the greater the time gain. For example, if you decided to reverse thrust halfway to your destination, the journey to Alpha Centauri would last approximately 3.5 years for the astronauts, which is shorter than the time it takes light to cover the same distance as observed from Earth, about 4.3 years. In this way, the potential for interstellar travel, even at high relativistic velocities, may offer fascinating opportunities for future exploration. However, the practical challenges and resource requirements involved in building and operating such spacecraft are significant and should not be underestimated. Furthermore, the physical limitations imposed by the laws of physics, such as the finite speed of light, cannot be bypassed entirely. Nevertheless, it's essential to consider these possibilities as we contemplate our future in space. And if it were to head towards the center of our galaxy, which is located nearly 30,000 light-years from Earth? Well, for those staying at home, the relativistic spacecraft's journey would last tens of thousands of years. But for those on board, it would only be about 20 years. In fact, if astronauts were to point the spaceship towards Andromeda, the nearest spiral galaxy to the Milky Way, which is over 2 million light-years away, they would reach it in just 28 years measured on board. So passengers on a relativistic spacecraft wouldn't even need many generations to explore the universe. For them, the time of an interstellar journey would be relatively short. Of course, if they decided to return, they would find everything completely changed. On Earth, hundreds or even thousands of years would have passed and more. Therefore, in reality, such a journey would be a one-way trip. If it could indeed be done, then we could achieve the much-anticipated Star Trek scenario, where spaceships travel effortlessly from one point to another in the galaxy. So does time dilation solve the problem? Well, unfortunately, no. As we saw earlier, to accelerate a mass more and more until it approaches the speed of light would ultimately require energy practically infinite. No currently known propulsion system could grant us this. Even if the energy problem were somehow resolved through methods we can't currently foresee, there's also the fact that a spaceship traveling at a speed very close to that of light would be in a particularly dangerous position. Space isn't empty. It's full of wandering atoms, which sometimes come together in more complex forms like interstellar dust clouds, galaxies, stars, and planets, while at other times only solitary atoms are traveling into nothingness. However, there's a difference between the probability of a collision between two hydrogen atoms in a cubic centimeter of space and the certainty of the massive particle flow that the spaceship will collide with during its journey. Particles are nearly harmless at low speeds, but with acceleration, they transform into a deadly barrage of projectiles and high-penetrating ionizing radiation, capable of severely damaging the spacecraft's hull and making it dangerously radioactive for the occupants. These particles, intercepted at speeds close to that of light, would have such enormous energy that they would become lethal to any form of life on board. Not to mention that at that speed, even passing through a thin nebular veil could lead to the complete destruction of the spaceship. Some scientists believe that the sheer amount of interstellar matter will be a sufficient factor to prevent a spacecraft from reaching speeds higher than 1/10 the speed of light, which, as we've seen, is far from enough to sustain a large-scale network of commercial routes and exploration. Even if all these difficulties were to be overcome, there would remain another problem, absolutely insurmountable. Time dilation would cut all ties between the spacecraft in transit and the home planet. Astronauts would depart with the understanding that they would never see their families, relatives, or friends again, unless they brought them along or didn't have them at all. Upon their return, they would find a society profoundly different from the one they left. But that's not all. Such a method of travel would not allow for the existence of interstellar institutions like the United Federation of Planets, which are founded on commercial and cultural exchanges between diverse races, presuming a homogeneous level of technological and social progress. A homogeneity that isn't compatible with the time required for interstellar journeys conceived in this way. What, then, would motivate a future commercial enterprise to send its goods to the other side of the galaxy, knowing that it could never see or communicate with the spacecraft to which it entrusted its cargo? Every spaceship venturing into the realm of Einsteinian relativity would essentially become a world unto itself, without a homeland and without a past. What sense would that make? I mean, what do you guys think? Will we, or will we not, be able to make this first leap to the stars in the future?